sorry, he's a technical regional technical manager from APAC Bangalore. Sir, we're going to address on the topic of artificial intelligence in business, say in finance.
Yeah.
So probably most of you might know that what are the applications of the finance, what are the application of artificial intelligence in the finance. So artificial intelligence has a long been used, you know, in the credit authorization screening, mortgage of risk assessment, project management and bidding strategy, then financial and economic forecasting, next risk trading, risk rating of exchanges and trading and fixed income investments. There are many more areas like security and asset portfolio management. So there are a lot of issues are there in the application of artificial intelligence in the finance field. Now I request Professor, we are going to further elaborate on this topic in a simple way. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay. So what you're going to be doing is that we'll be doing the whole of the session today split into two, three subparts, right? So we'll be first initially discussing more on the data science. And what are the aspects of the data science which can be
directly
Yes, sir.
Sorry. Okay. So first thing was we're going to be looking at how was the data science and what are the features of those data science which can be related to financial markets, right? So only if you are able to understand what is that in data science that we can probably start using in financial markets, then we will be able to better appreciate it, right? So once we're able to do that, we'll be able to understand how it is working, okay? Okay, so let's get started. First thing is, what is data? So like how we started off with artificial intelligence, we understood what is intelligence and then why it is called artificial, right? So first, let's see what is data. Data actually comes from the Latin word called datum, which is something is given, right? So anything that has been generated from the source as raw facts and figures is going to be called as data, right? So didn't we not have data in the first place before, or was that not properly used? And now that after probably 2010 with the advent of AI and data science that we have started using it, it is both yes and no. Okay, so as we already seen it, there are three important things that help in machine learning and artificial intelligence grow, right? So evolution of the tools, right? So tools have evolutionized the way the data is being captured as well, right? And so next thing is sensors. So sensors have improved over the period of years, right? And then computing also improved a lot. So now microcomputers have given way to PCs and PCs have given way to cloud computing. And now we are looking at big data, right? So how's cloud computing useful now? Can anyone tell us how is this cloud computing useful in the way data science and artificial intelligence is evolved as well? You can understand microcomputers becoming better with microchip and PCs and PCs becoming better with laptops and laptops becoming better with more smaller servers and stuff. But the biggest change or which helped artificial intelligence was cloud computing. Access from anywhere. Yeah. So what did you mean by that, ma'am? Access from anywhere and big data storage. What do you mean by that, ma'am?
Because we can access mm-hmm. any data anywhere using internet.
Mm-hmm.
Now I am attending your lecture sitting in Mumbai.
We always had that, right? Because like say, for example, I'm housing an e-commerce website, right? So we were having an e-commerce server, like say I was having a server in my place in Bangalore and someone can connect in and log into mine. But what is the big difference?
We have a lot of data now.
Mm-hmm.
And the customers are all over the world. And so individual data centers may not be able to survive or cater to the requirements. So,
earlier, we were probably dependent on hosting our own servers. Obviously, the Tatas and the Reliances and the Aditya Birla groups were used to build their own server houses, right? So they used to have their own IT servers and it was workable for them. But just imagine that I'm going to start off with a small company with a small shop in Bangalore, okay? So if I have to have a software in place, I'm going to be starting off with a very small spreadsheet, right? Normal Excel for me to work with, right? Now I'm increasing footfalls. There are more people coming to my store. Then I think that, okay, I need to go and use some kind of an application, right? So some CRM application, customer relationship management application. So I'm going to go and see what is the cheapest CRM which is available. So in those days, we used to have this Shriram CRM, which was locally made. It was all available. So people used to go buy that and install it in their local machines. And they were using it for CRM software in India. And then just imagine that your business is growing. And if you want to open up multiple branches within the city, and then you had to open up multiple branches outside the city within the state. And then if you had to multiple branches outside your state within your country, right? The problem was that earlier, you had to be content with a local available software, which was allowing you to install in your server, which is already available in the hardware, okay? But nowadays, you do not have to do that. It is allowing you to rent it, right? Like say, for example, you do not need to own a Mercedes-Benz. What you have to do is just rent it for the time that you need it, right? So if you're going to use, like say, your full capacity of your hardware only for say 1 hour, every Sunday night or every Monday morning, I need to run these reports for my machine learning or artificial intelligence, then I can only rent it for that 1 hour and do those calculations and pay money only for that 1 hour. Earlier, what was happening was that I need to first have a place where I can store my servers. Then I have to put money to buy those servers and I have to buy the full license of the server and I have to keep it in my storage place and I need to put people to maintain that as well, okay? So now you do not have to spend all those time. So just imagine that earlier times, you had to use your Ferrari only once in a month to do your calculations, right? For that, people were actually buying a Ferrari and keeping it in your garage without using it for a month and were using it only for 1 hour per month, right? It was a costly business. Only those rich people were able to afford that. So artificial intelligence and machine learning was not reachable to the masses. But now this cloud computing actually broke those ones, right? So now you do not need to own a Ferrari. You need those resources. You need those computing power, but you need it only for that 1 hour. So you pay for the rent for that 1 hour, use it, and then come out. It is as easy as logging into your Gmail account, checking your mail for half an hour and coming out, right? So that's why cloud computing had a huge, huge way of significance in the way machine learning and artificial intelligence made a breakthrough in the last 10 years. Okay. Any questions? Feel free to stop me if you have any doubt. Okay. So this is one of the most common question that I keep getting, okay? So what is the difference between business intelligence, machine learning, artificial intelligence, data science, all these terminologies are being interchangeably used, right? So are they the same or are they different, right? So this is the easiest way to understand what this is about. What was companies doing earlier before 2010 was reporting what has happened. Like say, for example, if you go for a meetings in your company, they used to say that this is what happened in last quarter. We need to correct this so that you can do better in this quarter, right? So what was being used was we were using some BA reports, business intelligence reports, to do some reporting on what has happened in the past so that you do not make the same mistake in future. Okay. What was wrong in that, or what was the problem in that? This was what
we become reactive, not proactive.
Exactly. So what do you mean by proactive, ma'am?
You have written here actually predicting future.
Exactly. So when I mean predicting the future, what am I trying to do? What am I actually taking into account? I'm certainly taking into account what has happened in the past, but I'm adding a few things along with that to predict the future. What am I trying to add?
What are the new things which are going to come that we will take into consideration, and then we will predict what will happen in the future?
Yep. Let's take the same example that we used the last time, right? So what was happening earlier was, just imagine that you have a Google map, and the Google map you're giving from here to there, you need to go. So in business intelligence report, what was actually happening was that typically at 12 o'clock noon, there will be no traffic. So you can take, if you take the car, you can reach from Silbo to Matarli in 25 minutes. Okay. That is what business intelligence was trying to do, right? But what was this machine learning trying to do was that, okay, this was the historical data, but tell me the current data between Silbo and Matarli. What is the traffic between those two places at this point of time? What is the weather at this point of time? So you are adding the environmental variables which will influence your decisions at this point of time, and then it will help you to come up with a conclusion of how much time is it going to take for you to travel from Silbo to Matarli. So that's the difference between business intelligence and machine learning. Okay. So now comes the bigger question of, okay, so this is machine learning. Now, what is this data science? Data science is interchangeably can be used, called as decision science, right? Based upon whatever your machine learning algorithm is going to tell you, the decisions or the business decisions that you're going to be taking, by which you're going to create a new future for the business, is called data science. The whole art of this thing by which you take decisions is going to be called as data science, right? Now, I may probably be telling you a shocker, but artificial intelligence is very, 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 very rarely used in the purest form in business now. Only 5% of your companies in this at this point of time in the world actually use artificial intelligence, right? So as we told last time around, you are machine learning and data science is widely used in business now. But artificial intelligence is, you do not even have to tell the machine what to do. It will automatically understand and take a call of what to do at that point of time, right? So like a driverless car, that is called artificial intelligence, right? So we are nowhere close to what we can achieve in artificial intelligence. What most of the data science world is actually currently doing is somewhere between machine learning and data science. And very few people are actually being involved in artificial intelligence like Tesla. So as how did we get here? We had better sensors like scanners, point of sale machines, medical sensors, crowdsourcing mechanisms, all helped us to get here. Communications, network infrastructure, communication and compression technologies helped us to faster communicate. Storage, we discussed about cloud storages, NoSQL databases. Any idea what is this NoSQL databases about? Did anyone cover in the sessions earlier? So the typical way of storing data in table format in relational database is called SQL queries, right? So you use SQL queries to query and take it out from the data. So suddenly what is happening was that the time that was spent for a query, queries in this, basically what is query is a user request, right? From a user request for it to retrieve the data from your tables was actually happening, taking longer time. Okay. So we had to have another mechanism by which we were able to quickly render the details that were requested by the customer. Okay. So, but this was nothing like what was heard about in the last 2-3 decades, right? So we were using, the banks were the first pioneers of using computer technology, right? So, and we wanted to ensure that the data is correct, right? So, and we used to have this normalized way of handling data, 1N, 2N, 3N, NN way of handling data. But NoSQL databases were actually first coughed at and laughed at when they were talking about it. Now, NoSQL databases like MongoDB is everywhere now. So what is this NoSQL database? You do not need to store data in the form of tabular structure, okay? You can store data as documents. And what does a document contain? So if you open up an Amazon and search for something, what we expect is that whatever you search on, that query, actually goes into their database, searches for all the details in a particular table, and then get all those details. Like say, for example, it picks the data from all those seller tables, it will pick the seller data. It will take the product details from product data. It will take the consumer ratings and everything, consumer feedback, everything from consumer data. So, and then it will then go to the artificial intelligence, machine learning, algorithm page, and then it will get all those recommended items data. So one small query that you write, like say, for example, I'm searching for a particular book, then it has to go back to this database and fire some, look into some 6-7 tables internally, and then collect all that information, put together that all that information, and then show that page to you, right? It was actually more cumbersome and it was taking a lot of time for us to render it back to the user. Then how can we make the turnaround time faster? Anyone? Are you able to understand the use case that I'm talking about? Do you want me to show a demo of how it is, what's happening? Let me share my screen. So if I go to Amazon, so what's happening now is if I want to search for a book by say Rudyard Kipling, okay? Rudyard Kipling. So I'm going to search for Rudyard Kipling books. So the moment I click on this, okay, you see all these details which have been showed over here. So now, say for example, I'm going to search this, look at this Jungle Book. The moment I click on this Jungle Book, okay, now just imagine this. the moment I click on this Jungle Book, look at the information that has been shown on this page. It has to first, Jungle Book, it has to pick the picture of the book. Then it has to go into the price details and find out what are the different types of prices and the types of availability you have. It has to go and check into the seller page and get all those seller information. And then it has to go and put the details of the book. And then it has to go and find out the machine learning has run and it has put frequently bought together. It's also come. This is another machine learning table. It has picked up all the details which were bought along with this book. So there's so much of information that has been picked up and shown at the same time, isn't it? So each one of those details would have been stored in different tables. So it has to go to so many different tables to pick those details and come back. It was supposed to take so much of time, but it actually gave it to me in a few seconds. So what could they have done to display it faster?
Are they storing it together, connected data?
Very, very well said, ma'am. I think so. That was the major breakthrough that happened when e-commerce introduced NoSQL databases, right? The main reason is people buy one among the 20 things that they see. They do not buy 20 things, right? They just want to see it, right? Once I click on something, then only the query will go into those tables. Like if I click on add to cart or buy to now, only then it will go to the details and then cross verify if the price that has been given is correct or not in the table and all. Otherwise, all these details are actually stored as document. As say, for example, for Jungle Book, and then all these documents are actually stored together so that when I click on Jungle Book, only the document is picked up and shown to you. Okay, that is called NoSQL database. It will not go and verify the authenticity and everything like how it happens in the banks database. So, but the moment I click on add to cart, it's a different thing altogether. So the moment I click onto it, then on the backside, it will fire in and go and verify if it is available, and then it will check if it is has to be in the same price or not. That is the reason why you see that some of the times you buy it, you see it at a different price, but when you go and make the purchase, it's at a different price, isn't it? So that's what happens in the back. So that was the major reason behind what we had called as NoSQL databases. Okay? So MongoDB was a big reason why the e-commerce websites and machine learning was able to flourish. So now data is everywhere. So we get data from all different domains. Okay. So and now adding on to top of it, we are having this problem of big data. So Google, like say for example, is generating close to 4 billion searches per day. So what is this big data? Big data is defined by three V's: volume, velocity, and veracity, right? So it's a huge volume of data which is being generated in an unimaginable velocity, right? It's called big data. So we are having so much of data to be worked with, but so we have the data. Data is being generated by everywhere in different domains. Okay, so let's see a simple use case, okay? If someone is going to give you these numbers, what can you say about these numbers? This is data, right? But what can you say about these numbers? Can you tell something about this data?
Stored in an Excel sheet.
Yeah, Excel sheet. But if I'm giving you this data and asking you to tell me something about this data, can you tell me something about this data? No? Okay. You can. Can you generalize something about this data?
numbers up to 10.
Exactly. So you are trying something. Go ahead. All are below 10. Very good.
Between 3 and 10.
Okay. So now, if I am going to give you one additional context, okay? Imagine this, all these are scores by different sections of the same class for the same unit test out of 10. Now, can you tell me something about it? Can you tell me something about it now? Can you generalize something? Each column is actually the scores of each section of the class. Okay, so how did you come to that conclusion, sir?
Some students got out of 8.
Correct. So there are
out of 10.
Correct. Correct. 10 out of 10. So what can you say? So section E, there are a lot more 10 scorers than the other sections.
Yes. Good Correct. Performance, and these are average, very, this is slightly low performance.
Ma'am, you almost told it. You almost told it. You told something called average. What are you trying
average to performer, average
exactly.
performer.
Exactly. So now the moment I gave you a domain information, you were able to quickly apply statistics, which is nothing but average, right? Average is one of the statistic mm-hmm. measure, right? And you were able to say that the average of section A, section B, section C, section D is this. Then you can you compare a section with another mm-hmm. section's average performance? And how many top squares are there in each section? So what is more important here? Data or the domain?
Domain is important. More
exactly. The data so is important. You might have data, but for the data to be converted into an information, you need to have the domain information. So a data alone is not going to be, as it is, raw data is not going to be useful. You need to know the domain in which you are working on so that you will be able to convert the data into valuable information. So that is the difference between a data and information. So the moment you know the domain, and then you can find out how many total students were there in the whole of the section, what is the total score, what is the median score, mean score, count of 10s, how many students have scored out of marks, and all the stuff you can do on top of it, isn't it? So the only thing that I wanted to say is all data can be generated in many ways, but you need to use your domain knowledge to convert that data into information, okay? So now, what is data science? So it is nothing but data-driven science, right? So you're gonna use programming plus statistics plus business. So you have data, you're going to use these three things on top of your data to convert into valuable information. You're converting a data to information on which a business can act. Okay. So that is all about data science. Okay. So this is where data science fits. You have domain knowledge, you have programming knowledge, and you have statistics knowledge. So if you know all three of them, and then you become a data scientist, if you know programming and then you know statistics, then you are actually doing machine learning. And if a person is good in software engineering and he knows the domain knowledge, he can be there in the software development. And if he's good in statistics and he knows the domain knowledge, he can be part of the research activity. Okay. So data science on its own is a very valuable field, but along with that, you can be employed in these three sectors as well. Okay. So we have already seen that. So the travel industry, healthcare industry, education industry, all have been using data science to a great extent. So let's jump on to the domains, and then particularly to the financial domain on which we are supposed to talk about, right? So we are using data science to a great extent across the domain. Let's talk about three different types of analytics that are used. Descriptive analytics, inferential analytics, and then predictive analytics. Did anyone of your session is earlier covered this. Got it?
Not yet, sir.
Okay. So before we go to the types of analytics, let me try to tell you there are two types of data. Okay. So you have a data on which you are having some, say, six variables, okay? And you have a seventh variable which you are interested in, okay? I'll repeat it. So you have a data in a spreadsheet, okay, where you have six variables, and all those variables can be of different format. It can be numerical data, categorical data, qualitative data, anything that you want. And then you have a seventh variable or seventh column, which is going to be the variable that you are interested in, right? Okay. So what you're trying to do is, using these six variables, you are trying to find out the effect of those six variables on the seventh variable. Okay. So seventh variable is going to be the variable of attention for you. Okay. So if this is the data set that you have, then what you're doing is a type of machine learning called as supervised machine learning. Okay. So it's one of the machine learning types called a supervised machine learning. So what does that do is, there are a few things that you can do with supervised machine learning. So like what you did now, given a set of data, you can apply statistical measures, the primitive ones being the mean, median, and all the stuff. And obviously there are much more than those simple ones that you can use to find out how are these six different variables influencing the seventh variable. To explain how are these six variables influencing the seventh variable is called descriptive statistics or descriptive analysis. You are trying to understand and explain how the six variables are influencing the seventh variable. Did it make sense? Any questions? Did it make sense? Okay. So this is called supervised machine learning. Okay. Now, same set of data where you have six variables and then a seventh variable which is of interest for you. Now that you have done descriptive analytics on it, if I get a new data, okay, and you have the new data for six variables, but you do not have the new data for that seventh variable. If you are able to use machine learning and find out what that seventh variable could be, then it is called predictive analytics. Okay. Now, shall I explain it with a use case? Okay. Now, say for example, the easiest use case that I try to tell is house price, right? So like say six variables that I have in my spreadsheet is gonna be the size of the house, the number of rooms which are there in the house, and if the room number of balconies which are there in the house, the area where the house is located, and the proximity to the city center and all the stuff. Okay, so there are six variables that you have, and you have data over there, and seventh variable which you are interested in is going to be the price of the house. Okay, so what is descriptive analytics? You are trying to find out if proximity to the center, how much of it is influencing the price of the house? If the addition of one bedroom has any bearing on the price of the house? Is the size of the house has any influence on the price of the house? So those kind of analysis that you want to do with a given set of six variables and on the seventh variable you're finding out, it's called descriptive analytics. Did it make sense? Okay. Now, what is predictive analytics? So given this, if someone, are you able to hear me? Okay. So given this data, tomorrow, say for example, you are getting an advertisement for a new house and you get all the data for those six variables, like say this is the size of the house, and this is the number of bedrooms, this is the proximity to the city center, this is the builder name, and all the stuff you have. Yes, it's frames you have. Okay. Now, given this data, can you predict the price of the house? That is called predictive analytics. Are you able to differentiate between descriptive analytics and predictive analytics? Any questions?
Sir.
Any questions?
Yeah. Sir, in other way, we can say that describing the six variables with the seventh variable is a descriptive analysis.
Exactly.
Everything, what is the seventh variable is in a predictive analysis. Is it right, sir?
Exactly. Exactly. Predicting the seventh variable, given the six variables are available, then it's called predictive variables.
Yes,
okay.
Thank you.
Got it? Yeah. Yeah. Awesome. So the reason I'm trying to make you understand this is you're going to use these techniques, and now we are going to better appreciate how this is used in financial sector. Okay. So now third one is inferential analytics. What is this inferential analytics? Now just imagine that you have some 10 variables. Okay. And you do not have a variable of interest here. All the 10 variables are equal. You do not have any differentiation between those variables. Okay. Can you find some pattern within these variables? That is called inferential analytics. Okay. So like say, for example, I'll take the same set of data that we have, and you have some, along with those already existing seven variables, you have multiple more variables, and you have some 10 variables data. And you try to plot it in a n-dimensional scatter plot or something. And if you are able to find out that, like say, these type of houses, like say, a kacha type of houses, or say, for example, houses which are built with this particular type of material or something, is uniquely going for a higher price than the other set of houses. So if you are going to find out a pattern in the data, which was not easily available to see in descriptive analytics and predictive analytics, it is called unsupervised learning data, where there's no one variable for interest, and it is, the analytics is called inferential analytics. Okay. So the best example, the use case that I can probably tell you, I'm not trying to avoid to give you an use case from financial market, because we are going to see it in quick time now. But one easy one that I can probably tell you for unsupervised learning is that just imagine that you are, when there's one particular bank, I'm not taking, when you are trying to plot all the loans which were provided to the bank. Okay. So we found that out of the people who were not repaying the loans properly, there were two small clusters which were created. Okay. There was one cluster of people who were not paying the loan properly back, and there was another cluster of people who were not paying the loan properly back. Okay. So the bank wanted to understand more about that cluster, right? So one cluster was very obvious. It was those big rich companies which were being paid and they were not paying back. But there was another interesting cluster where the loans were not coming back. Okay. I'll tell you the qualities of this. The qualities are nothing but the variables. Okay. You can tell me. Okay. This cluster were aged between 16 to 25. Okay. And do you want more use case? Do you want to have more variables, or are you able to find out what is this cluster about? Who are these guys and what type of loan is this?
Education.
Young people.
Education loan. Education loan was not getting paid back. So they, when the bank was trying this analytics, then only they realized that, okay, there was a significant small cluster which was actually happening there. Then what happened is that they took those set of people data alone, and they wanted to understand about if they're able to understand more on that particular pattern. If there's a pattern available among those people, among those education loan providers, if there is some set of people who are actually paying back and some set of people who are not actually paying back. And then what they did was, for granting loans, they added additional columns based upon the people who are actually paying back the loans and understanding their traits and behavior and adding those as clauses over there. Okay, so that is what you call as inferential analytics based on unsupervised learning, where at normal site, you will not be able to find out what is happening. But when you try to dig deep using your machine learning will try to give you a few patterns out of it. Okay, so we will try to find out financial use cases on that. Okay, so broadly, there are two set of data: supervised learning, supervised data set, and there is an unsupervised data set. Supervised data set is going to have a lot of variables, but one variable of interest which we are particularly interested on. So, and supervised learning data set is used for predicting that one variable based upon those other variables. But unsupervised learning is primarily used when you have this data, but you are trying to find out some patterns in this data. Okay, so that is called unsupervised learning. Okay, so let's try to understand how it is being used in the financial sector. So banking, financial, we know that all the banking is not the only thing which is there in financial services. The financial industry consists of banking, credit card companies, investment funds, credit unions. Everyone are going to be financial industry. So we're going to be covering the use cases in all the financial institutions which we are going to be having here. Okay, so let's see how it is being used. So you're going to be talking about few important use cases. One is customer analytics, segmentation, attrition analysis, one bucketed together. Other one is the profitability analysis, then fraud analytics, anti-money laundering, and then credit risk analysis, and then customer support. Okay. So these are the use cases where we are using data science to a great extent. Okay. So now, based upon this data, based upon the use case I'm going to tell you, let's see if you are able to tell me if it is supervised learning or unsupervised learning. Okay, remember, supervised learning is going to have one variable of interest. Unsupervised learning is trying to find out pattern from the data. Okay. Customer segmentation in banking.
Unsupervised.
Okay, so what are you trying to do here? What are we trying to do here?
We are trying to identify different segments. We don't have any seven variable which we are comparing. Mm-hmm. That's why there is no supervising variable is there for which we are focusing on.
Exactly. Okay. So customer segment, different companies use it differently. Okay. This is what I was trying to put here. Based upon the interest of the group, they can do segmentation. They can also do it based upon the purchasing behavior, and they can also do it at the engagement level. How frequent are they engaged with that, right? So then they can key in all the data, take all the variables out, and see if they can be fitted into different clusters. So if I'm able to classify them into three clusters, then I'm going to target them accordingly, right? So let me try to tell you when use case, okay? Now, I have customer, and he spends this much amount, okay? And this is how he pays, okay? Let's say, for example, I'm a credit card company, okay? And this is how on time he pays me back or pay not or something back. So this, imagine that I have around 2 lakh, 20 lakh here, is it? 20 lakh customers, okay? So you have around 2 million customers, which is nothing but 20 lakh customers, but I have only 200 personal bankers in my bank. Okay, now just imagine from a banker perspective, whom do I want these 200 people to call? I cannot expect these 200 people to call these 220 lakh people, right? So whom do you want this personal bankers to be engaged with based upon this data?
High spending and not paying.
Well done. Very well done. So when you have a limitation on your resources, human resources, you would want to leverage their availability to the segment where it will be very, very constitutional for you to get the rewards as high as possible, right? So you do not, the premium segment is actually paying the payment well, and they are spending more than 2 lakhs. I don't have any problem over that. But the problematic segment is the segment which is spending more than 2 lakhs, but they are not paying you, right? So you would need those personal bankers to engage with them to get them to pay back, right? Or at least give them an incentive to pay them back. Introduce the EMI scheme for them to pay it back. Make them, because you do not want to lose them because they're spending heavy, right? So they are high value customers. So what is this customer segmentation try to do is, depending upon your credit history, the way that you are spending, it will classify your profile into one or more. Here for ease of benefit, I'm trying to put it as into 3 different segments. It can be more than that, okay? So all that segmentation that you see about credit cards giving you this platinum card, gold card, ruby card, and all those stuff, they are actually segmenting you, right? So that you, they can treat you differently, right? So all that they're doing is that if you've been given a ruby card or a platinum card, then you feel privileged, then they are not actually allocating resources for taking care of you, because all that you have to do, you're paying well, you are a good, nice customer to them, and you are also getting the benefits from this ruby card or platinum card. So I'm not going to spend my bankers on you. But I have this normal gold card customer, but he's spending, but he's not timely paying me back, but he's really worth. But I'm not going to move him into the platinum card or a ruby card. I'm going to keep him in gold card, but I'm going to ask a personal banker to be engaged with him so that he pays the back to me and he doesn't leave me and go to another credit card company. And I'm not going to be worried about this guy. He's not going to spend and he's not paying also. So I'm fine if he leaves me and goes to another company. Okay. That's customer segmentation. So attrition and churn analysis. So this was actually taken from one of the telecom company. Okay. So just imagine that you have 2 million customers. Okay. And you have only 50 call center employees and you have only 4 zonal managers. So number of times that person has complained on the phone is, say, this is the column. Number of times he has paid visit to the bank. Number of times he has raised disputes. Number of complaints he has raised. Number of complaints that have not been fixed so far. And non-resolution percentage is this. Okay. What set of data is this? Is it a supervised one or unsupervised?
Unsupervised.
Very good. Do I have a column which says a person has left me or not left me? It does not have a column which says it has left, a person has left me or not left me, right? Because all these guys are currently with me, but has the potential of leaving me if I do not do anything, isn't it? So what am I trying to do? I'm trying to find some pattern among the data that I have, right? So if I give this data to my machine learning algorithm, it's going to give me clustering and pattern mining, and it's going to find out and tell me these set of the customers are having similar characteristics of leaving you. So I'm going to ask these 50 call center employees and the 4 zonal managers to engage with them, right? Instead of engaging with all the 2 million customers, I'm going to be concentrating on those X customers that my machine learning is going to tell that focus on them, okay? Makes sense? Okay, let's see the next use case. Okay, so this was another customer attrition one. After we provided the data into the system, it gave back the result like this. Okay, what can you infer from here? This is age of the customer. And this is the percentage of churn. if you are a banker manager, what will you do? Does it have a relationship in the way a person churns is nothing but leaving, leaving a bank, okay, and going to another bank, okay? So does age have a relationship with the churn?
Yes, it is having.
Yep, so that is very much clear. Where is that happening?
Young age, around 30.
30 to?
40.
40, 30, 30 to 39 or 40, right? Mm-hmm. So the most attrition is happening between this age, right? And you can see that the moment the customer crosses this age of 40, he almost stays with you. He doesn't churn at all, isn't it? So if I get this data, right? So what will I do? I will probably engage with this customer more proactively till around he's 40, 41 years of age, right? And after that, I know that he's not going to leave me, right? Got it? Now, this is the outcome of unsupervised learning, okay? So if I have lots and lots of data and if I'm going to plot it into a dimensional graph, this is what I was talking about, this small clusters being created for people who are taking loans and not returning back, right? So this is how their data will look like. So you will not make sense from the unsupervised learning data results directly. What you need to do is, the machine learning will give you clusters. It is trying to identify that this green color people do not churn and these yellow ones churn. Okay. So there are people over here who are actually churning a lot, isn't it? Right. So what will be the next step from a bank perspective is we will group this people together, these orange and this yellow color guys together, and try to find out who are these guys. Is there any particular variability or any kind of behavior which is common among these guys which is making them churn, right? And then take these yellow ones and find out what's causing them to churn, right? That's how your result of your unsupervised learning will look like. Okay, now say for example, if one of my results of supervised learning is going to throw out this, okay? So F score is the significance score. So this is the variables that I have considered for how much important these variables are for a person leaving or retaining with the bank, okay? So it says that balance is the highest, credit score is also going to be highest, age is third highest, and so on and so forth, okay? So now if you are from the bank, how will you, what will you do to retain people? We already saw in the previous one that age is actually having a significant influence on people leaving. Okay. Now you know that balance and credit score is also having a significance bearing on people leaving. So what are you going to do?
Customer having a more balance than the age group of 30 to 32, I will try to engage. Mm-hmm.
Brilliant, sir. Okay. So people who are having higher balance and with good credit score within the age group of 30 to 38, they are my priority customers. Isn't it? So you are right, people, sir. Okay. So that is going to be my strategy for engaging with the group, okay? So now let's jump onto the credit risk, okay? So this is another use case. So just imagine that there are 2 lakh applicants for the personal loan, and you cannot expect a person to sit and accept or reject it, right? So these are the applicants. This is gonna contain the number of credit cards that a person is holding, number of 30-day payments he has defaulted, number of 60 days payments he has defaulted, number of 90 days payment he has defaulted, civil or FICO score, and number of liability products, number of cars he has owned and everything, and fixed deposit amount. So this is all the bank is going to have about you, right? And then I'm going to decide if he's going to be high credit risk or low credit risk. What type of data is it? Supervised or unsupervised? Do we have a variable for interest here? You would have historical data of granting loan and not granting loan, isn't it? The person who was a risk guy and not a risky guy. So you will already have the data for them. And for any new data that you're going to get, you're going to be classifying them as high credit risk or low credit risk. So this falls under supervised learning. Okay. So
based on logistic regression.
Logistic regression. Yes. So I'm happy that have you guys already been introduced to logistic regression?
No.
No. Okay. So when your predicting output is going to be numerical, it will be linear regression. But if you are predicting output for supervised learning is going to be a categorical variable. Your categorical variable is a non-numerical variable, then it will go into logistic regression, or you can use random forest or division trees. Okay, so one among those three can be used for this. Okay, so what I'm trying to do is, given a set of data of X columns, we are trying to predict the outcome if a person is going to be a high credit risk or low credit risk. So there is no person sitting over there who's granting the loans and not granting the loans, or classifying a person of credit risk or not credit risk is the machine which is actually doing now for all the banks. Yeah. So this profitability analysis. So every bank's summit, and whenever there is going to be a change in the RBI repo rate, they need to factor in the new customers, the prospective of new customers that they were going to get in. What is the customer attrition that has been happened for the previous quarters, and the repayment that is due for them. And what is the fixed cost, the variable cost that the bank is owing, right? And then they need to redo their rate of interest, right? So the banks do this whole calculation. They don't sit and do it. They actually are dependent on a data science program. So, and then say, for example, if considering all this, and if the repo rate is also not going to be changed, if I am going to change my home loan interest rate to 8%, then what is going to be my profitability factor, considering this is going to be my variables, right? So then what the program is going to say is that this is going to be the returns for these 4-5 years, and if this is going to be the returns, if you're going to keep your ROI as 9%, if your ROI is going to be 10%, this is going to be your returns, then I need to take a call if I have to keep it at 10%, or if I have to keep it as 8% or 9%. Right? So profitability analysis, also data science predicts it. And obviously it is not as straightforward as linear regression over here. That it's a combination of both supervised and unsupervised learning that is being used in profitability analysis. Okay. Fraud analytics. So this is one of the most advanced use cases that has been used in the data science. What is the main difference between fraud analytics and what the others that you have seen so far? What is the difference between this use case and all the other use cases? The clue is time.
We have to detect the fraud at the as soon as possible.
And before the transaction is happening.
Correct.
Right? So for the rest of the stuff, all the transactions happen. And the next time when the transaction is going to happen, I'm going to be doing the analytics for all the other use cases. But for fraud analytics, when the transaction is happening, I need to do it real time to stop, right? So the time is of very much essence over here than compared to the other use cases. So it is very, very time sensitive and resource sensitive than the other one. So, but actually it is, what I would say is that it is quite resource sensitive as well, because fraud analytics is primarily a more of an unsupervised learning algorithm than a supervised learning algorithm. And unsupervised learning, that's more of trial and error method. So it is going to take some time. So how is that fraud analytics works? So say, for example, I have a typical customer who is uses card and signature for his card and PIN for his purchases. He typically uses his card for groceries, shopping, Swiggies, and Zomatoes and stuff. And he's classified as a medium type of a customer for me. So he's going to be a customer who uses his credit card for, say, paying 5,000 rupees to maximum 10,000 rupees per month. Okay. Now, suddenly, this same customer is making a transaction in the middle of the night from a location which is completely different from where he is situated, and he's buying an Audi car, an expensive item than what he normally purchases, and he is using a different mode of payment for using the card, and he's for a huge amount, and then his location is different. Then what it's going to do is, on real time, it's going to create an alert. So data science algorithm is going to create an alert, and it's going to block your card, right? So I think you moved away from blocking the card now. So what happens is that it is going to ask you one additional feature for you to validate that you are the person who is actually making the transactions, right? So less than 1 lakh, it will go ahead and do it, follow you. I think if it's going to be more than 1 lakh or any amount that your bank has specified, it's going to ask you for additional verification code, right? Sometimes you get a call from the bank to verify if it is you who is actually making the transaction, and then only allow you to make those transactions. That is fraud analytics. It is primarily used based upon unsupervised learning, where you try to predict, find a pattern which is different from your normal regular pattern of work. Okay. So what it tries to do is, this is how your normal work is, normal purchase and spend is. If you find an outlier, it will create an alert. So this is what happens on the background. If this is the way you are spending expenses, if it alerts to any outliers, the alert system gets triggered. Okay, so that's what is happening. Anti-money laundering works on the same concept of unsupervised learning. So you have amounts which is going to be different from the previous way that your account was used. And if the source was different from the one that you have already been using, then it will trigger an alert and it will capture it into the anti-money laundering software as well. Okay. Coming to the last part of customer support. So this is where I think we have banking systems and the financial markets have made huge strides and are making huge strides in the wake of pandemic and people stuck in from lockdown. So chatbots and voice assistants, if you have not seen this, probably you can Google Kaitlyn and see it. So Bank of America used this one almost 4 or 5 years back, where it was in just like Alexa and Siri. It was a primarily a voice assistant, which was helpful for detecting your voice and having your voice plus other mechanisms to validate you and make transactions within your phone. Okay. So Bank of America first time launched it, and now lots of other companies are also doing the same. Okay. So as I told you, I think I didn't use this slide in my first session. Life is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get. Similarly, data science is like a box of chocolates. It keeps trying to help with different use cases at different points of time to different domains. You never know what's going to be coming out of it. The only thing is, hopefully the humankind is aware of it to make use of it ethically and not use it unethically. Okay. Any questions?
Is there any questions?
No, sir.
No questions at all, sir. Yeah, one question from Hasta Gupta. Can unsupervised
learning and reinforcement learning be together? Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, reinforcement learning is that third type of machine learning. So reinforcement learning is nothing but when you pass the feedback, because obviously machines are going to make feedback, make mistakes. So you're going to pass those feedback back to the machine learning algorithm as inputs, and it will start making lesser and lesser mistakes, right? So like say, for example, the machine learning is going to say that don't give loan to this person, right? But you override it and go ahead and give a loan to that particular person for X, Y, Z reason, right? So then you pass that feedback to the machine learning telling that, okay, for such cases, you need to give loan. So next time onwards, it will learn and it will go ahead and give loan to that particular person. So it works both ways, right? So if you're gonna give a person a loan for your own personal benefit and pass that feedback again, the machine is gonna learn the wrong thing and will keep churning out wrong results, right? So in such a way, it's just a machine. It's going to learn whatever feedback you're going to give. So its most important thing is that the feedback has to be really good so that it will keep learning from itself. So both supervised learning and supervised learning can be used as reinforcement learning. Reinforcement is nothing but whatever decisions that you have taken, take those results, and wherever the mistakes are, make the machine learn by giving it as back as input. It is called reinforcement learning.
Sir, could you tell me about how artificial intelligence works with the stock market?
Okay, so I think that's one place where people are not able to break it through, because stock market is something that's completely, human desire related, right? So it is people have been trying to break their heads by trying to predict it, but not to a great extent. So we can try to do prediction in stock market, but not to a great extent. You can probably around close to 60-70% predicted, but nothing more than that.
Sir, can I answer? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Dinesh, sir.
Sir, in the stock market, there is something known as algo trading.
Yep. Yeah.
Yes, sir. In algo trading, artificial intelligence are major role in artificial intelligence.
By that good.
Algo training, people say that they have been using it, but I'm not sure. See, basically, algo training is nothing but method of executing orders using automated programming, right?
Yes.
But that is more of an automation. That is not something that uses data science to a great extent. Okay, so it is primarily when something happens, do something. Okay, but data science is not going to predict something from those variables which are already there. Data science does a poor job over there.
Okay, sir. I'm not sure about that. But I think it will. It has to work in artificial intelligence.
It should use data science for sure. But I don't know how much of it is going to be useful over there. There's obviously an automation involved there. But see, basically, it will assess the market situation and it will allow you to take decisions, but not to an extent how you use it in other domains, like how you use it for data-driven decisions over there. It will certainly help you in automated decisions. Basically, there's a difference between automation and creating data science products, right? So it certainly is going to save a lot of manual time, but not to an extent where it's going to be replacing your prediction of stock market. That is not going to happen. Yeah.
Yes, it can work in this thing, no? Like fraud detection and all.
Exactly. Fraud detection, it will work because there is a clear sequence over there that's happening there for a period of time, right? But stock market is like It varies of nature. People react differently at different point of time, so you cannot predict it.
Okay. Yeah. Sir, emotions play a major
role. Emotions play a huge role. Exactly. Yeah. So it's primarily based upon sentiments, right? So that is very tough to
Hello.
Okay. Yes, awesome. Sir. Yeah.
Is there any questions from participants? Yeah.
Okay. What is precision and recall? Okay. Precision and recall, you need to know about classification to understand precision and recall. To tell you in very short, how much of your prediction is correct is called precision, and how much of wrong prediction, how much of the wrong predictions that you have done is actually correct is called recall. Okay, so like say for example, there are two things that you will predict, if it will go right or go wrong, right? How much of the going right have you predicted correctly is called precision. How much of the going wrong have you predicted correctly is called recall. Okay, so that's precision and recall.
Okay.